Our guest today is the co-founder and COO of Snapback Energy, who uses her extensive banking background to drive positive change. After her husband's death, she founded Snapback Energy, focusing on the mind-body connection. She is also an Ayurveda health and wellness lifestyle coach who radiates support and uses podcasts to spark conversations on neuroplasticity, Ayurveda, and holistic wellness. She embodies impactful change through her unique blend of entrepreneurship and holistic living, promoting self-discovery and transformation. Welcome to the show, Tessa Arnold.
Thank you so much, Mike. I am so incredibly excited to be here and have this conversation with you. And thank you so much for the intro. I think you pretty much summed it all up. Got quite a bit going.
Boom, right there. That's it. Episode's over. Go to snapbackenergy.com. Here's Tessa.
Find me.
Play some music. Peace out. No. So guys, thank you for being with us, whether you're tuning in right now on YouTube, Apple, Spotify, your favorite podcast app. We love that you're here with us. This is going to be an energetic episode. Snapbackenergy.com. Check that out while you're tuning into this. And here's why I love it right out of the gate. Three things caught my attention, Tessa.
Yes.
It is vegan, gluten-free, dairy-free, which means I can actually enjoy it. Mm-hmm. And that is something that I don't find a lot. People hate going out to dinner with me. People hate that when I was just at this retreat last week and I had to watch the menu for dairy-free and gluten-free. Right. And I don't always eat vegan or vegetarian, but I pick and choose my battles. But I love that this energy drink is all three of those, because that means everybody can enjoy it and they don't have to really worry about it. So let's talk about it. Let's talk about Snapback Energy. I know it sounds to me, and I'm sorry to hear that your late husband passed, but it sounds to me like after you were able to kind of stomach and get through that, and then you can share as much of that story as you want, you continued to build, create, grow, and you didn't let that moment define you in a negative way. It sounds like this horrible thing happened, mm-hmm. and now I'm going to go and keep working hard, almost like as an honor to him is what I'm kind of gathering from looking into your story. Share that and then tell us what Snapback Energy is all about.
Absolutely. Thanks so much, Mike. Yeah. So it's great. You know, the product itself, and I love those key points that you shared into why it really drew you into it, because that's the intention. It's meant to be for everybody. And I wanted to allow everybody to really enjoy the benefits of what Snapback does. And I know that there are quite a few dietary restrictions. I wanted to get to a broader customer base. It's also caffeine-free too, but still gives you the energy boost. So yes, Snapback came about sort of from like the left side. My late husband had an idea for an energy drink, almost like a 5-hour energy. There was a name for it. I was supporting him as sort of from in a partnership just as a wife, and then transitioned to really coming on board and developing Snapback what it is today. And then, yes, we went through our children and I went through the experience of just being shocked and losing him. But still having Snapback sort of as our lighthouse in the storm. And to your point, it was in honor and in memory of him. He actually got to see it launch our grape flavors, the first flavor that we launched with. It was his flavor. And we launched it. He got to see it before he passed. And that was really exciting because I had worked very hard to get it up off the ground. And I had to take over at the helm while he was going through what he needed to, and to take a step back before we launched. And so I was really leading the charge with our wonderful team at Snapback. And I was like, well, I'm going to get this going. I'm going to get it off the ground, right? You asked for me to come on board. I never give less than 110%. I was still very much in banking, right? So I was still within the security of my banking role. But I was like, I'm going to go all in. That's kind of what I've done my entire life. And I'm pretty gritty. I had dealt with loss before at a very young age. I lost my father in a boating accident at 12, and then my brother in a car accident in my 20s. Yeah, so it was very much this, we all come together and are connected through trauma. And to your point, and you know, the essence in what you share on the show, you can, you know, fall victim to that and be a victim of that. Or you can look with, you know, just understanding, okay, this has happened. What am I going to do to continue to push myself through it? And for me, getting gritty showed up quite a bit and doing quite a bit of work and some healing there. So that's where Snapback really came into play for me, that I was like, all right, I've got this off the ground. Now I'm at the helm of this company. What am I going to do? And I was like, well, I've been putting all of my thoughts into it, you know, my embodiment of health and wellness. and really developing my own understanding of the health and body connection really through the pandemic and post-pandemic. And since then, we've launched an additional flavor, which is the orange flavor, which is fantastic. It's like drinking sunshine in a glass. It's a beautiful way to start the day. And we're currently working on a third flavor in development, which has all the good stuff, like the adaptogens, which are intelligent plants that go into it and really help that my body and truly the body function and connection. And then also has greens in it as well. So that will be the third Snapback product in our arsenal. Snapback for me was really a call to action to accept, coming into play in this, accept taking over the company, accept working with this beautiful team that we have of veterans and women and getting it off the ground, getting it started, but really not just being another product out in the market, right? It was more of a call to action to do better for ourselves. And when we do better for ourselves, we're loving ourselves, and that includes our body.
Yeah, that's incredible. You fully transitioned now out of the banking world into entrepreneur. Yeah.
Terrifying.
Because that's something that, it takes some time to, and obviously that leap of faith.
Yes.
But how long have you really been creating this product and get it to where it's at today? I mean, and again, you mentioned with your husband passing, how recent was that?
Sure. So that from start to finish, the idea of the product all the way up to what it is now has been about 6 years. But it's been out in the marketplace the better part of over 2 years. And then we're coming up on the 2-year anniversary of his passing. And it's just, to bring it all up, he's incredibly proud. I know he is, looking at everything that we've accomplished. I will say through the majority of the time that I was getting, working with Snapback and developing the company and the brand and learning all the ins and outs of entrepreneurship. Because I didn't have the degree in business. It's kind
right.
of drink it from the fire hose as you're going.
Yeah.
And you learn
hard knocks, man. You learn as you go
really
and make those adjustments as you go as well.
And you falter and you fall and you ask questions and you have to sit at the table and really be super comfortable and vulnerable being like, I need to know what that means. I need to understand this. Give me a crash course in this. Right. And then also you can't be afraid to find people that you want to emulate, people in the business. Reach out and make connections, right? Your network is one of the strongest resources that you have, especially with people who are also doing it too. That's why it's so incredible podcasting and what you're doing here with your podcast, right? And all the people listening, you have two great resources here. You've got resources all the way out. That's one of the beautiful things of the internet. The silver lining to it is we do have that connection. But that's not what I thought I was going to be going into. I had a pretty significant career in commercial global banking. Right. So I was VP there. I had worked for two large companies. It was secure. It was safe. I had my whole career mapped out, the trajectory we're going, financially, it was very secure. People, I had an incredible network of people around me. There's nothing that I could say negative about that. That's not the intention there. It just wasn't my path. And I shared with somebody earlier this week, I said, as long as you entertain and maintain what's not for you, you delay what is for you. And that was
say that one more time.
Yeah. As long as you entertain and maintain what's not for you, you delay what is for you. And that's for all things in life.
So important. I think a lot of times we have a hard time saying no to things because as entrepreneurs, we're always problem solvers. We figure it out. We always want to figure out how we can make it work. When people come to me with an idea, they want me to help them with it. They need some just help in general. A friend wants to get together, just like random moment, and I have 84 things that need to be delivered that week. And I'll be like, as much as I want to say yes to hearing about it or maybe helping, or it's a project that could be really cool or it sounds great, the best thing we could really do a lot of times is say no, right? Or at least delay it. And because otherwise we're delaying our own purpose.
We are.
And we have to remember what our purpose is for the day. And if we allow, even if it's a positive thing and someone that has a cool idea, to give them too much time initially, then it delays our own purpose. Like
it
you just
does.
Said, that was really, really well said. The other thing I'd love to hear about, and if you can elaborate more on, is the idea that this is an energy drink, but it's not filled with all the junk that you get in a lot of the competitors. So where did your interest in holistic health come from? Obviously, there's more to it than even that. And can you share a little bit? I want to make sure I'm saying it right again. Ayurveda, how that's all connected into this. It's woven really literally into it. I know it's more than a buzzword. So can you give us a scoop on that?
Absolutely. It's a journey. It's been a journey. So I'll have to break it down to a few parts. And I want everybody to hear that because, yeah, there's beautiful synergies within it. But it was very difficult. Journeys are, I think if we looked up or we gave a definition to it, right? You're meant to stumble. You're meant to fall. You're meant to break down. They're supposed to be difficult, right? As is the journey of life and as is the human experience. We're constantly evolving. Yeah, and mine has been nothing short of that. And it will probably continue to be. And that's perfectly all right. I welcome it. So through this journey, I'll say just a moment on the snapback. Yeah, we really took the time, worked with a food scientist in developing the formula for that. We are so incredibly proud to say, and it took a lot of work to get this done. I went 3 passes with the patent office to get our formula patented, which specifically provides liver support. The liver performs over 500 functions in your body, and that's why snapback is as close as you can get to probably magical for your body, and why it does provide you that energy without all the other things that your body just does not need, right, in a very natural way. So that propelled me on a journey of really starting to look at, you know, the pillars of health and what I was ingesting and what I was putting into my body, my energy levels, you know, being a young mother and having 2 kids. It was just to try and keep up the energy. I was sleeping. I was working out some, but through banking and through just life itself, I had lost the balance of myself. I had lost the ability to balance life. And I was way over on the other side where I was putting out, as you mentioned, without saying no, so much that I lost sight of taking care of myself so quickly that it just snowballed. And then I was so far removed for taking care of myself that this was also, you know, a call to health for myself. And when I started to make the small little changes to start to embody that health within myself, my journey started to propel, which inevitably took me into a retreat. So I went on a retreat out of the country by myself, did not know a soul. And this was this year in February. And I decided, you know, and it was a journey to that. Some things had happened. I had finally left banking, which took me better part of 6 months, almost a year to decide that I was going to do, because that's scary. And I will be the first to connect with anybody on that. Taking that leap of faith, you know, propelling yourself from the shore, going out into the horizon, the unknown is terrifying, especially when it's very secure. But my soul was aching for something more and I couldn't turn away from it anymore. It was too uncomfortable. I had to leave.
Well, something too, I know, obviously in entrepreneurship and whether you have one product, multiple products, running the business, you're in the business, you know that there's so many different things that need your attention.
Right.
And I've been in this boat, you know, the entrepreneurial boat since 2017. And a lot of times I've had health issues and things where I just not intentionally let it go or get bad or, you know, including my liver. I remember going to the doctor doing blood work for insurance and they were like, you get fatty liver at one point. And I was like, I don't even know what that means. That sounds horrible. That sounds like I have like, and they're like, it's okay. You're at a point where it's reversible. You just take care of your health and your diet. And, you know, when a lot of times I'm in front of my screen for so long that I'm not getting the activity. So you got to get activity in other ways and stuff. But I share that with you because you just talked about the liver, 500 functions.
Yes.
It's not something you could take lightly. Like that's super important. But it's not something that I'd say everybody just is wired to think, I got to take care of my liver. Like we know that, but we don't necessarily think it out loud like that. So I'm glad that you brought that up. And that's just one example of many. Your mental health, sleep. Sleep is something that every time I hear someone talk about it, I'm like, I know, I will get some sleep.
Yeah.
But that is definitely something I think many entrepreneurs struggle with is when to call it a night. Because we always have the one more email, one more connection, one more line in my blog, one more hour of editing, right, is what we're usually doing. And we end up not taking care of ourselves. So I'm glad you mentioned that. But you felt it.
Yes.
Like, I have to get away. Everybody has a moment. It's like a tap out moment, you know, where you just know I'm going so far in the wrong direction that I know there's going to be a moment when I'm not going to be able to correct it. Similar to the liver. If you keep going in the wrong direction, it's cirrhosis, right?
Right.
I believe that's the right term.
Yes.
And it's not reversible.
It's not.
So talk about how you, or if there's entrepreneurs tuning in right now and they're head nodding because they're driving, listening to this, or working out, or whatever they're doing, they'll listen to this or watch this, they feel that.
Right.
What do you suggest they can do to be mindful to put some of those things that you did in place for yourself that they can do for themselves?
So much. You said so much there, Mike, because I love the term tap out. I love that because it does get to that point where you're like, you call uncle. It's like, this is enough. And you don't necessarily know where to start or why, but it's so uncomfortable. And why is it that, and it doesn't necessarily just have to be entrepreneurship, but in life, we are always the first ones that we turn away from. We're always.
Yeah, it's because it's almost like we're trying to prove it to ourselves and not in a way that we need a trophy, but we're not easy to knock down because we get so much adversity thrown at us just because business has a lot of adverse things that come your way. Payroll, finances, taxes. This person's sick. You got to do that work. You can't leave. All kinds of stuff. So we're so used to being like, no, we got it. We'll figure it out. But there's a moment where it's like, that's actually going too far because if you're not taking care of yourself, your health, your well-being, your mental health, how are you going to have mental integrity if you're basically a zombie? So
how are you showing
I appreciate
up?
You saying that.
Yeah.
How are you showing up in the world to your team, to your customers?
To everybody around you, to any interaction you have. How are you? I challenge everybody and say, yes, you're doing the thing. You're putting in the late hours. You have, you know, the work, all of the timetables to show for it. And you can show me all of that. And it doesn't mean much to me until you tell me, how do you feel about how you show up? Because at the end of the day, when you've accomplished all the things, and you're sitting with yourself, I want you to check into your body and I want you to tell me how you feel, right? Because if you can then go and enjoy, it's almost like you're holding bated breath, waiting to enjoy whatever it is that you're waiting to enjoy, waiting for that break, waiting for that, you know, moment where you reach that monetary value, whatever it is, I'll sit with you and we'll have a really, you know, heart-to-heart conversation about why are we waiting and why can't we take a moment and truly balance what it looks like to incorporate that into your life now, to incorporate fulfillment and health into your life now. And that's where, you know, there's quite a bit. There's the six pillars of health, which really drew me to the Ayurvedic practice. So I heard about this on the retreat. I started to slowly put it into practice and it felt too good. And it was just too simple and it made too much sense not to leave it alone. And it was the missing pieces of the puzzle that I had been missing along this whole journey and where I had gotten to that point of so far removed from myself and my health that I was like, this is what I need to get back to. And I'll tell everybody right now, we'll go through this and I'll share with you and you'll come off of this podcast and you're saying, I promise I'm going to get better sleep. Promise I'm going to eat better. Start small, but I'll tell you right now, the most important promises that you will ever keep in this life are the promises you make to yourself. Please keep those promises, please. You are the one that you are going to be with the longest. You are the one who's going to be at the end of this journey with you, and you're going to do your reflection. And I want you to look back and say, yeah, I did it, and I did it well. I did it healthy. I felt good in the moments. I wasn't waiting for this time when I was going to take care of myself or a time I was going to take a break. Because I'll talk to you all day long if you'd like to about longevity. But we don't need to talk about longevity until we talk about the quality of your life right now.
It's so good. I just heard something recently. It's not about going, you know, far like distance-wise, but it's more the width of life that we're trying to fill up to.
Yes.
I don't remember the exact quote, but the idea is that life is to be filled up and not just go a direct line to our gravesite, you know? But you're talking about, obviously to be well and enjoy those things the most, you have to take care of yourself and hold yourself accountable. And the word that came to my mind when you were saying that is confidence.
Yes.
When you tell yourself you're going to do something, you do it. As small as I'm going to wake up 15 minutes earlier, you know, or even if you want to get up 2 hours earlier than what you're doing now, you don't typically start by 0 to 2 hours. Like you'll go, you know, if that time you're getting up now is 8 and you want 6, then try, you know, 7:45 for a day or two and then 7:30 and you can get yourself on schedule. I'm over here preaching to the choir, by the way. So I'm full transparency. I'm learning and also going to be applying things we talk about for myself.
That's wonderful.
Now this next word that's on the in my notes here, I was just at a retreat recently too called the Tiki Hut Retreat in Florida, and I gotta give a shout out to Todd Saylor, who was the host of the event, and it was incredible. And I'm wearing the Wire Differently hat. He'll be a guest on the show in the very near future. And he talked about neuroplasticity. But on a very, I want to say general, like it was important to the conversation we're having, but it wasn't so much the science behind it. I'd love you to share a little bit more of the science behind it, because to me, neuroplasticity just means the brain can shape, heal,
yes,
kind of grow, not grow maybe in size, but grow as far as information, adapt. Is that, am I understanding
you
that
are,
right?
You are.
That's a little bit elementary, but can you give us the scoop on it?
Absolutely. No, you did in such a great way because, and you said a couple of things there that tie into it beautifully. You know, you said just reflect on your own life and the things that you're going to take away from this. And it's practice. Everything is a practice. And we don't go through life achieving the ultimate. I mean, unless you're Yoda or somebody who's coming there. And I don't know that people exist. Like even the Buddha or other people, you know, from a spiritual practice, there's constantly still a practice. Doctors practice. Attorneys practice. I'm a yoga teacher. I practice. We're all constantly doing it. And I'd say to everybody, being a human and living a human experience in life is a practice and you're constantly evolving. So please give yourself some grace and understand that we're on a journey and it's going to continue to evolve and unfold. And that's where neuroplasticity really comes in. So it is a beautiful study on, you know, what's happening with the neurons in the brain and how they fire off and how we really think about things and apply emotion and thought to different experiences that we have in our life, right? So emotions are thoughts in motion through the body. And when you work through neuroplasticity and you start to put small practices in place, you almost retrain your brain in certain ways. So you have a beautiful practice that you share of gratitude. I myself put that into my daily practice. I wake up, I think about things that I'm grateful for. Things come into my life, you know, through my flow, through going out into doing the things that fulfill me and in service. And when they come into my life and I feel that elation, I automatically give gratitude, right? I want to spread that out into the world because then magnetically and through vibration, you're bringing that back into the world. So that's when you train your brain like that and you start to put these practices in place, it's also a technique of rewiring, if you will. Think of it as a giant computer, right? So you're rewiring to neurons and new memories and experiences, not based on old computing, which a lot of that comes from early childhood, which we don't even necessarily realize, or past feelings or emotions. Maybe they were told to us. Maybe we were told how we should feel about this. Maybe we saw something. But it's habitual.
Most of that wiring happens in the first six years, right? So by the time a child has their seventh birthday, most of that computing is built. And then, unfortunately, you got to try to rewire it. And that's funny you said the word rewire, because that's literally the definition and explanation that Todd was using. Yes. We're talking about wired differently is how we are as entrepreneurs. But he was also saying using I believe it was like a car battery, not a car battery, but like a car motor.
Yeah.
It's all got the coils all wired around it. And it's like by the time you're 7, 8, 9 years old, that's all tightly wound already.
Yes,
and then you do have to kind of rewire it. And that's the neuroplasticity in our brains that allow us to do that, which is almost like we're almost like have a superpower.
We do.
The fact that we can do it.
Absolutely.
We can do it.
And people don't realize that. No, you're not stuck with that. But do you, we can talk so much about this. So you're not stuck with that, but you have to realize when you become consciously aware, when you have the awareness of what your thoughts are and how you're feeling for a moment, right? That's the first step. And then you decide we are not defined and we are not our thoughts, right? Our thoughts are coming in. It's almost, you think about it as a giant computer. The screen comes through, the thoughts process. There are gaps in between thoughts. That's where meditation practice comes into place. You really fall into the gaps in between thoughts. We can't have one continuous one, otherwise it'd be a jumble of chaotic noise up there and it would make no sense. So I tell people simply when you go into a meditative practice, which is a beautiful, it's one of the six pillars of health, you can really start to be aware of your thoughts, right? You're never going to stop your thoughts. They're constant, but you can become more aware. And so something comes in, right? The ego's up there, right? The ego's talking to you. You can picture ego however you want to. The ego lives in a place of fear as a protective mechanism, right? So the ego is telling you to run and go into your sympathetic nerve reaction to fight, flight, or freeze because we're being chased by a crazy animal back in the prehistoric time. So whatever it is, from early, you know, development of the brain, you have your sympathetic nerve, you have your ego is coming from a place of fear to try and protect you, sometimes based on past thoughts that have been built in that, you know, conception to 7 and even a little bit further on, is telling you, that didn't work out before. What if you fail? What if this happens? This doesn't feel good. This is uncomfortable. Okay, so you've got to be aware of that. You've got to love the ego, right? A lot of people tell you, no, get rid of it, you know, or it's the best thing. No, find a middle ground. Accept it for a part of you.
It has its purpose. It can't be the end all be all.
Exactly. And it's not this terrible thing. And it's not the decision maker, but it's a gift to be able to say, yes, I do realize that that's what happened last time, but I'm a little bit different now. This is a different situation. I'm going to go into it and I'm going to lean in. And yes, I might be a little bit afraid to do it. And that could be in all things in life, especially business and entrepreneurship. But I'm going to lean in because I'm going to give it a go. And that's what the intention of life is about. Your intuition is never changing. It's all knowing and it's not wrong. But your intuition is going to come from a place of peace, right? It's going to be calm. It's going to be steady. It's going to be that voice where you ultimately know what you should do. We don't always listen to it, right? Nobody's perfect. We're human. But the combination of the two and the neuroplasticity, you can start to really rewire your brain in stillness and awareness of your thoughts to determine, is this what I truly want to think? Is this the emotion or the thought I want to assign to this experience, right? So even just being aware of what's passing through in the mind and the thoughts that you think is very powerful. And then there's neurogenesis too, which is the creation of additional cells within the brain and the hippocampus. So it's really incredible, the things. So I don't know if you know this, but we typically only use about 10% of our brains.
Yeah, I've heard that a few times. I'm like, oh man. And what about us? Who uses less than 10%? And I'm like, don't look at me.
Right.
You know, it's incredible though, like, not to change the subject, but we can get back to that, is I was just thinking about how we heal. You know, and like, in a way we really, you know, it's like amazing if you think about it. Now, major wounds, the body's not going to be able to heal from that, like the Terminator.
Right.
Remember, like,
right.
The bad Terminator, like you could shoot his arm and like it just comes back.
Regenerate.
But think about it, like if you have scars, like we have scar tissue, like our body will heal as best it can. We're constantly changing, growing, learning new things. Like the body is this huge, living, beautiful, orchestrated thing that is really a miracle when you think about it. Like the fact that it's what it is. And I think so many times we just accept things like that's what it is. You know, it's almost like a kid today.
Right.
If any kid that's less than 10 years old doesn't appreciate a cell phone.
No.
Right. They probably won't even know why I called it a cell phone. They're like, what did you call it that for? It's just a phone. Mobile phone, you know, tablet device. They don't appreciate it. My daughter does that, but still not fully. Because I explained, like, you know how we just picked that movie? Like, here's what we used to have to do.
Right.
We would get in the car, we'd drive to this place called Blockbuster, right. And we'd look at the store, and there'd be about 10,000 options, just like how, you know, on Netflix you scroll through. And I'm making her picture this in her head. And I'm like, and then we would go and we'd pay for it, like $3, you know? And then we'd drive back home and watch it, and guess what? And she'd be like, what? I'm like, if you want to go watch another one, we got to do it all over again. Like, that's the process of choosing. Now it's all there. So going back to our bodies, I think the thing about rewiring your brain and everything is that, you know, it's constantly growing, adapting. And there's something that Todd talked about, and I feel this is important to our audience. ANTS, A-N-T-S, automatic negative thoughts. And they pop in your head. And you could be the greatest athlete in the world, the greatest CEO in the world, a brand new entrepreneur, anybody in between, a pastor, this, that, a doctor. We have these automatic negative wired thoughts, whether that's ego, you probably would know more than me. Sounds like it could be ego driven. And we need to, the cool thing is we can stop the transmission. We can be the security guard. And the way I'm learning to do that is to use gratitude in that moment. So like, if I have a negative thought, like, oh my God, I'm not going to be able to get this done today. I got too much. Like, why tell myself that? Stop. And then get into gratitude right away. What are three things I'm grateful for? Don't even say the negative thought anymore.
Exactly.
So, that's essentially rewiring your brain, right?
It is. And it's so beautiful. You said so much there. And I will say the Terminator, I just want to say the only organ within the body that can regenerate itself is the liver.
Skin, right?
Liver. Well,
oh, the liver.
Can to oh, the within liver. The body. Yep. So the only, it's the second. So the epidermis, your skin is the largest, you know, living organ.
Organ in our body. Yes. And it regenerates itself, what, every 10 years? Is
yes,
that accurate?
Yeah. So, and then the liver can regenerate.
That's kind of freaky. Freaked me out when I heard that. I'm like, what? Well, like I'm shedding like a snake.
Your skin. But it's a beautiful thing too, right? It's that evolution too. So yeah, there's mm-hmm. so much there. I would say for the negative thought, first, I want to say to everybody out there about negative thoughts. So, and right, a lot of people are trending with the manifestation and what that looks like when we get into the mindfulness. And that's a beautiful practice. I would say there are no limits on anything that we can do. The only limits that we have in ourselves are self-imposed. So I would challenge you all to think about the limits that you put in yourself and why you can't. And then I would break all of them. Mm-hmm. And I will help you do that through my coaching if you ever have questions or just want to bounce ideas. But I would say we have an intention, right? So we have an intention with whatever we're going to do, whatever, you know, part of our life that it's in. And you put attention to it, right? A lot of people talk about that. You have your intention, you put your attention, right? But that's not enough. You've got to put action behind it. But I challenge that and I say, but that's not enough. I want to know what your thoughts are. Because if you're putting the intention, the attention, and the action, but you're speaking those negative thoughts to what you are capable of doing in yourself, you're still not going to get there. You stop that train of thought in the tracks and you say, thank you. You say, thank you for showing me this. And again, I do a lot of work with my clients and I'll talk to them and we'll dig into why that thought comes up. So we'll even take it a step further and get into some shadow work, into some early childhood trauma potentially, into where that self-talk started. But forget about that for a moment, like you said. A quick thing that you do right there, stop and think about it like a train coming down and it's rolling down some funny little, you know, characters at the stuff. And it's like, but we can't like make it comical. I love that. Make things funny again. Kids, there's our childlike, you know, qualities that we were told.
Like a goofy security guard pops up like, sorry, you're not allowed in the party, negative thought.
Right.
Like, you're not on the list.
You're going to fall on your face. And I'm like, thank you so much. I could potentially, but then I'm going to get out, dust myself off, and I'm going to just rock this right now. You know what I mean? And then make it like, that's how I go through life. And I have two kids myself and I have embraced, they are my teachers and they have shown me so much. They don't live in that place of what if and fearfulness. They live.
How old are your kids?
10 and almost 9.
Awesome. Yeah. My daughter's 8. So.
Yeah. So it's like.
Right in that wheelhouse.
They live in that place of curiosity and I can do all the things and I can do this. And they ask questions. And when I started to really go through this journey and take stock of myself and look within, I was like, who told me I had to lose that? Who told me I had to grow up and forget about all that stuff? Why can't I continue to live my life in such a way? You know, curiosity has always been one of my core values. It's something that's lived within me forever. I will never stop mm-hmm. being curious. Life is a culmination of experiences and we are the agents of our lives. So if you're not having fun, if you're not challenging yourself and if you're not getting uncomfortable, then I don't know that you're fully expressing it, you know, to its fullest mm-hmm. ability and getting everything you can from it. And yes, that's scary. But my children don't go, nope, can't do that. You know, my son can't jump off the couch and pretend he's a superhero and go fly and be like, that's too scary. I'm not going to do that. No, he's going to go experience. And sometimes
he can, but there's consequences to it.
There are too. And it's a beautiful practice of, you know, they do things. They were taking surfing lessons this summer and I'm watching them sitting on the beach. Why am I sitting on the beach watching them? You better believe that next lesson I was out there with them and I was taking surfing lessons and I was like, this is so much fun. And that's how I continue to lean in. And it's not always going to be, right? But we do need to challenge ourselves. And complacency is where dreams go to die, right? Because you become that negative thought pattern. You get too scared and you're like, but this is comfortable and this is known and I know what to expect. Yes, but what about those dreams? What about the things that you're just denying because, you know, they seem out of reach? Why can't they be in reach? You know, make space for the unimaginable and then go seek it and find it.
Oh, that's beautiful. We're going to take a quick time out. That's a nice little exclamation point on the end of the first half of this conversation. We're going to give our sponsor some love. We'll be right back with Tessa.
Podcasting is a great way to engage with your audience and stay consistently relevant. The only problem is you don't have the time or desire to produce your own show. You simply want it done for you. And that's where Social Chameleon comes in. All you need to do is press record and upload the files. We'll handle the rest. From planning, production, post-production, distribution, and digital marketing, we have you covered. We realize that times are tough and funds are tight. And Social Chameleon believes in building supportive business relationships. By clicking on the link in this promo, we'll provide you 7 free podcasting tips to get started, as well as a free 30-minute online consultation. This is the perfect opportunity for entrepreneurs, keynote speakers, industry experts, influencers, and anybody who has a personal brand. With Social Chameleon, we help you build a brand that is out of this world. We're ready and waiting. So what are you waiting for? Click on the link to get started today. Hey guys, it's Mike. I'd like to give a proper shout out to Navigator Bookkeeping. Look, for a long time, I ran my business without really understanding the full financial picture. I used my gut and my bank account balance to make decisions, which led to some poor choices and constant stress over my business's finances. I knew something needed to change. At the beginning of 2021, I made a decision that helped pave a more clear path for my business. I started working with Navigator Bookkeeping. Since then, my bookkeeping has been handled for me. I now understand the full financial story of my business, making important financial decisions much easier now, and it helps me plan for where my business is going. I highly recommend giving Navigator Bookkeeping an opportunity to help your business. Check them out at navigatingyourbooks.com. Again, that's navigatingyourbooks.com. It's time to know the full financial story of your business.
All right, we're back in action with Tessa Arnold. And remember, you can connect with her on social media. She's on all the popular apps out there, kids. And her website's linked in the show notes. And I do that for a reason, so you don't have to worry about typing it in on your phones or tablets, whatever you're using to tune into the show. It's clickable there for you. You can check out Snapback Energy. So what if an amazing first half of the conversation here? I know we don't have a whole nother half. What I'd love to do is at some point have you back on the show, because Tessa, right before the break, you were talking about how we're always learning, growing, adapting, changing. And it made me think that, like, if you see someone every 2, 5, 7 years, like that family member that's out of town, you might see him every other Christmas or every 5 Christmases, maybe a birthday. And every time you see them, they're the same exact person. And it's kind of sad when you think about it. Like, they haven't done anything different. No new life experiences. They haven't challenged themselves at all. And you're talking about constantly being in this place of learning, growing. Let's learn how to surf, guys. Let's take go with my kids. And your kids were excited, and you were kind of maybe watching them. And then you realize, I'm going to learn this too. This is so much fun. And they probably had even more fun with you by their side, right? Because they're learning with mom and showing off a little bit, I'm sure,
right?
When they were getting the hang of it. So, yeah, super important, embracing that. And then also kind of trying to break down the ego was part of that conversation, what I love. So I'd love to have the conversation that maybe the next level of it, going from fear, turning that into courage. A lot of entrepreneurs are tuning in right now, and some of them are startup entrepreneurs too, right? Because that's really our audience. So they're maybe afraid to take the leap,
yes,
and they got 1 foot on ground, 1 foot in the ocean. They need to learn how to swim or surf, if you will. That's the analogy we're using. What would you share with them?
Absolutely. So there's a couple of things there. And I would say, when I speak with entrepreneurs and we're going through this, I say to them, they're like, well, it's been done before. And, you know, it's been done. There's something else similar out there. And I was like, yes, but nobody's done it as you, right? Nobody thinks about things the way that you do. Nobody speaks about things the way that you do. Nobody has the thoughts that you do and adds that touch that you're going to out there and resonate with people the way that you do. And that's so true. I mean, there's rarely anything that we're putting out today that, yes, hasn't been done before, and we're emulating because it has such a profound, you know, effect on people or connection. I hope that's what we're putting out in the world, right? So we're meant to be selfless in sharing our gifts. And I'd ask everybody, you know what your gifts are. And if you don't, go back to the things, the qualities that when you're expressing yourself in a certain way, it feels so good and you feel so fulfilled based on what you're doing. That's a gift, right? It's a gift of what you're putting out into the world. You know, you have the podcast, and that's such a beautiful gift, connecting with people, bringing in the conversation, sharing with your audience. I would commend everybody who's listening, right? Because they're taking the time and the steps to really figure out to connect with their gift and connect with themselves and to be bold and be brave. And I think that's part of it, right? And to practice that, you know, gratitude. I would say when you start out there, start small, but set the intention, mm-hmm. the action, right? The attention, and then eliminate those thoughts. Those thoughts are going to come in, laugh about it like Mike and I do. Think about the crazy guy in the train. Picture the little, you know, guy jumping up, the little clown. However you want to do it, you know, make that little caricature. And they're saying, I'd be like, yeah, I got it, but I'm going to do it. Because I'll tell you, right, we don't want regrets at the end of this experience. And then people will say to me, well, what if? And I say, what if? Let's talk about the words, what if? Yeah. What if it's incredible? I can counter all of your negative thoughts with positive ones. And we could do this all day long. But I'll bring you what's the most beautiful.
How much time you got? Because I'm right here.
I will hit every one of your negative ones. But that's not the point of it. The point of it, why waste energy there? The past is a dream. It's gone. It's totally erased. Mm-hmm. Right? We're not going back there. The future, we don't know. And thankfully, we don't, because I challenge everybody. And when people tell you, where do you see yourself in 5 years or 6 years or 3 years? And I tell them, I don't know because I don't dream big enough yet. And I constantly say that to myself. I don't need to know because I know I've got to relinquish control of that. I've got to continue putting forth the effort. And if I'm doing good for the greater good of others and myself, right, then mm-hmm. that can't be wrong, right? Because it feels good in my core and I'm seeing it impact others in a positive way, right? I'm going to leave people better than I found them. And I'm going to try to leave the world a better place than I found it, right? And I will falter and I'll make mistakes, but that's a beautiful part about being human. So I would say to them, let's not have that conversation of what if, right? Past is gone, future, we don't know. Keep saying that to yourself, but what do we have? We have the present moment right now. And they'll be like, I don't have time. You do. Challenge you there too. Put the phone down. I was like, now let's look at, phones and connection. And now we're constantly being inundated with stimuli and you're looking and you're scrolling and there's benefit to seeing what you want to start and maybe seeing other people's, but then put the phone away, have a time limit on that and go out and create your own. Take the inspiration, take what you have and then go create your own. Don't compare yourself to others. Again, there's nobody else like you who can do the things that you do.
Mic drop moment right there. Tessa's just spitting fire. That's so good. Yeah, the quote I love, be you, everyone else is taken.
Yes.
Right? So everyone has their own superpower version of themselves, and it's always a work in progress. But whoever you are right now, you can serve, you can help.
Yes.
Even if your glass isn't full right now for yourself, you could still pour a little bit of yours into someone else's because they just needed that little bit for the day. You know, you don't have to save the world or solve the world. All of our problems in one moment and one day, like you chip away at it, 1% better every day attitude will get you way further a year from now than if you try to solve a massive problem right now. But the other thing you said too is the what ifs, like if you try to, you know, live, like you said, in this questionable state of what if this, what if that, you know, I don't know if I want to do that because I don't know if I'm ready. You can just sit there and you'd be like you were with, surfing,
right?
A bystander.
Right.
Well, everyone else is learning, growing. Like if your kid stayed and did lessons twice a week for a whole year while you were the bystander, what's your progress personally going to be in that situation opposed to right there by their side in the water with them,
right,
with your own board? You're trying, they're teaching you, you're teaching them. You're going to learn things a different way. You know your children so well. You can pour into them. I'm sure the instructor that's helping, if you're working with an instructor, they're going to know the three of you and how you, like a really good coach teaches everybody uniquely because they know how to pull at their strings in a good way, like, you know, your heart strings, if you will, just like in a relationship. It's that magic moment that's why people connect because the compatibility is great. And a good coach knows that. So you don't get any of that by sitting on the sidelines. So I love what you just said. That was really well said. I know we are kind of wrapping up here and got to jump. This is fantastic. I'm going to continue to follow your story. You're a friend of the show. You can come on anytime you want. Just send me a message. And this is a conversation today that's like a chapter one, I feel like. We got a lot of good stuff out. But there's so much depth to what we're talking about.
Right.
Can you tell our listeners right now, Ayurveda, lifestyle coaching. You know, I know we've talked about it, but how does someone get in touch with you specifically? I'll have it in the show notes, but what does that journey look like working with you?
Absolutely. So you can go to thebalanceofyou.com and you'll find all the information there. I really encourage you all to, because we talk about the six pillars of life. It's simplistic. It's beautiful. It's things that you can do right now. It's not, when I first was introduced to it, I didn't have to change my diet, you know, with this wild fad diet plan. I didn't have to buy anything. I didn't have to go see anything. It was just very much practices that we work to incorporate, like breathing, like sleep, like nutrition, like movement, all the things that are available to you now, right? We all breathe. Mm-hmm. A lot of people don't realize it's the shallow breathing that we do right into our lungs. We're not breathing into a diaphragm. We can control our whole nervous system with our breath. It's a beautiful. So simple things like that. It's just a beautiful way to balance you as a human being through life. Practices that, you know, I'll help assist you with understanding that you then take with you on your journey. And I hope I run into you again and again, because that's the embodiment that I just want to put out into the world, because it feels good. You then, what happens is you vibrate at a higher level of frequency to all the people around you. Your energetics, as you mentioned, it's such an incredible thing, the way that our bodies can heal ourselves. We work on the energy, we work on the nutrition. I truly want people just to wake up to a life that, you know, they feel so incredibly good in their bodies. And it's not always the case, but they have the tools and the resources to get back to homeostasis and balance as much as possible. So then we can start talking about longevity and the quality of your life. Things start to really feel good. And you do that for your partners. You do that for the people you work with. You do that for your friends, for your family, for your children, right? When you start to take care of yourself and love yourself, you become strong enough to catch and show the ones around you, you know, how they need to take care of themselves.
So good. So well said. Put a great bow on this episode. I'm excited to get this out to our audience. This is going to be perfect for them, whether they're listening to it first thing in the morning or maybe midday or whatever. It will energize them. This is going to be an energetic episode where people, it's all about that reset.
Yes.
You know, and you can, you talk about breathing. We talk about rewiring the brain. I think sometimes if we think about rewiring, it sounds like a process. Right. We got to do a lot of this work, but literally like breath work. Is so, I've done a couple things in sessions with people where they've helped me with some breathwork stuff. It's pretty instantaneous relief as far as what you can do. Our bodies are computers and machines, but they don't always need to be rewired or plugged in or right. This and that. It could be a couple of moments of breath and stillness that can really change the momentum of our day just in a 10, 30 seconds maybe.
It's right? Quick.
It's incredible.
Instant gratification, mm-hmm. Right? We all love that word. It's the word we live in right now. And it's like, yes, I'll give it to you. And you already have the tools that you need to be able to do it. How simple is that? Right?
Yeah.
We don't realize it. We're so busy thinking that this is normal and it's not. No, we should feel good and we should feel peaceful as much as we can. And we should be comfortable in stillness, right? And that's, we walk through a meditation. I work one-on-one with my clients. I love connecting with them. So yeah, it's great. We can walk through all of that.
Cue Stillness of Heart by Lenny Kravitz. And let's play that through without getting sued by his attorney. But Tessa, this is awesome. Snapbackenergy.com. And the other one was thebalanceofyou.com. Is it Y-O-U?
Yes.
Thebalanceofyou.com.
Yes.
Tessa Arnold. What an amazing human being. Thank you for your time, your soul, your energy today. I really felt it coming through the waves here. Thank you for your time. This is awesome. I'm grateful for you.
Yes, thank you. So grateful, Mike, and so grateful for everybody. And thanks for having me.